This video provides guidance for the prudent storage of the chemicals used in the modern biology laboratory. It is intended to supplement the formal instruction provided in each institution and each laboratory. This video is not a substitute for a safety training program. Empty laboratory shelves, waiting to be filled. Yet there's much about the safe storage of chemicals that we've learned, but don't quite remember. Suppose, like Dr. Mario Gimona and lab assistant Lisa Manchi, you are just moving into a new lab. It's a chance to put all those chemicals into logical, convenient order, and along the way, to review the principles of safe storage. How well would you do? Before we get started, here's a question. All of the above. Of course you knew that.
You've got your glasses with you?
Yep.
Very good. So, let's go.
So we can sort A down here.
Okay.
The first instinct, naturally, is to arrange alphabetically. For convenience, nothing makes more sense. But of course, it's compatibility that has to take preference. This first group of materials that Mario and Lisa have brought from the old lab are dry chemicals, which can be stored together. Alphabetizing them is a good start.
Mario, what would you put this under?
Oh, that's a chromatography resin. That we could put under B for the beads.
B?
But there are important exceptions. Do you remember some of the guidelines? The color-coded labels are a handy reminder, though not quite as useful as they'd be if all the manufacturers used exactly the same system. Compatibility tables are designed to guide you through the maze. Here's another question for you. Unfortunate, but all too true. Even so, you may find them useful when planning your experiments. The main strategy for ensuring compatibility is straightforward, based on all those principles you've been acquiring since introduction to chemistry. Keep organic and inorganic chemicals segregated.
Look, there's an unopened bottle of boric acid.
They've decided to return this bottle to the central storeroom. Good thinking. The basic rule is, don't keep more on hand than you need, especially with hazardous materials.
All finished?
Yeah, looks good.
Very good.
As they put the first group of items in place, they were careful to use the top shelf for things less frequently needed and that aren't too heavy. By the way, raised lips on shelves can prevent containers from sliding off in case of earthquake, fire, or accident, and they are highly recommended.
Want to put them up on the bench?
With the arrival of the liquid and more hazardous chemicals, the storage guidelines now become a bit trickier.
Yep.
Good.
Hi.
Thank you, John.
All right.
John. See you.
With some of these materials, there are formal limits on the quantities you may store. But even within the limits, common sense says, keep in your laboratory no more than you'll need over a reasonable span of time.
So I think we should sort them now into acids and bases, flammables, and some that we have to look up later on.
The idea is to determine major storage groups that are practical and consistent with the policies of your institute. But Mario and Lisa know it doesn't pay to guess. Any chemical they're not sure about, they look up. The MSDS or other authoritative reference can provide guidance for proper storage.
A special place later on with all the mutagenics and poisonous things.
Okay.
They well know that some materials, like peroxide formers, can become highly dangerous if stored too long. With diethyl ether, for example, once opened, storage longer than 6 months is risky. You're asking for trouble if isopropyl ether is not discarded within 3 months after being opened. Mario marks containers of time-sensitive materials with the date received, and he'll mark them again when opened. Lisa and Mario have arranged a separate storage area for caustics. But even within this cabinet, they store different types of caustics apart from each other and in plastic trays that will catch any spill or leakage. This may be a good time to ask you about the hazards of organic chemicals. Combustible or flammable. Most organic chemicals will burn. However, flammable liquids can ignite at or near room temperature. Note that Lisa and Mario place their liquids on lower shelves. If something ever leaks or spills, they'll be glad to have it come out below eye level. All their cabinets are carefully labeled to cut down on the chance of putting an item in the wrong place. Oxidizers should be separated from other chemicals because they are highly reactive. For example, nitric acid can react violently under certain conditions. Acetic acid, ethanol, or a mixture of acetone and sulfuric acid. Storing corrosive, toxic, flammable, and highly reactive chemicals near a fume hood encourages use of the hood when transferring chemicals. For storing acids, Mario uses trays that will catch any spill and at the same time provide adequate segregation. And what are the hazards of oxidizing acids? Corrosive and highly reactive are correct. One recommendation, which Mario follows, calls for storing only mineral acids, including nitric acid, in the acids cabinet. Now for the flammables. Here's another question for you. These chemicals belong in the flammables cabinet. And how should the materials be organized? Larger quantities, say above 4 liters, should be in a metal container, or better still, a safety can. You can store organic acids and organic bases with the flammables, but of course carefully separating them. Again, there are formal limits on the quantities of flammables you may store. If there's any question, your safety officer has the answer. Don't store flammables in a refrigerator unless it's approved for such storage. Next, how about toxic materials like carcinogens and reproductive hazards? Lisa and Mario will keep them in a separate cabinet. Any toxic materials that are also volatile belong in a vented enclosure, such as the flammables cabinet. Keeping an inventory of all highly toxic and highly reactive chemicals is good safety and good sense. The overall layout for Mario and Lisa's chemical storage is quite simple. The shelves for general chemicals. Vented cabinets for flammables. Chemically resistant cabinets for acids and bases. Oxidizers and toxics stored near the hood. Only cleaning materials should be stored directly under the sink. In a lab with less space, the acids and bases can be stored in one cabinet, but separated by plastic trays. Reagents and routinely used chemicals are kept in small quantities above the bench. Mario and Lisa will soon be ready to resume their research project. They'll work in the knowledge that they've increased their own safety by following the principles of safe storage. Wouldn't you agree it's worth the effort?